Praise the Lord. I welcome you to a leadership development session tonight. I pray that the Lord will enrich our heart as well as our ministries with his word and his spirit in Jesus' name. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we bless your name. We thank you for keeping us alive and keeping us awake. And we thank you because of the passion, because of the zeal you have given us to keep on serving you, especially in times like this, serving you and serving the body of Christ and serving the local churches. We're asking, Lord, that tonight once again, that you will speak your word to every heart. Give us, Lord, greater understanding and help us, Lord, to plunge into the ocean of the blessing of God that we receive for ourselves, receive for our families, and receive for the ministry, receive for the church of God. And we pray, Lord, will be blessings to the people of God more and more in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Tonight we come to three Psalms in the Bible. Psalm 22, Psalm 23, and Psalm 24. All the Psalms, of course, are very important. But these Psalms in particular, Psalm 22, Psalm 23, and Psalm 24, are very important for the gospel, very important for the calling God has given us. As we look at Psalm 22, you see, he's talking about the Savior as well as our salvation. You think about Psalm 23, and he's talking about our shepherd and the fullness of his supply. And you think about Psalm 24, and he's talking about the Sovereign One, that he is the Glorious One. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and now he'll be coming back in glory. And so, in Psalm 22, you have the good shepherd. In Psalm 23, you have the great shepherd that provides for all the needs of the sheep in the flock. And in Psalm 24, you have the glorious shepherd that is coming in glory. And then he'll take us to glory. Look at Psalm 22. Psalm 22, verse 1, my God, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why art thou so far from helping me and from the words of my roaring? You recognize those words that Jesus spoke on the cross of Calvary when he gave his life for the ransom, for the redemption, and for the salvation of the whole of humanity. And this depicts and shows us the shepherd, the good shepherd. In John chapter 10, reading from verse 11, John chapter 10, verse 11, it says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. The good shepherd giveth his life. That refers you back to Psalm 22. Look at verse 17 here. In verse 17 of John chapter 10, it tells us that he, the Lord himself, he gave his life. John chapter 10, reading from verse 17. Therefore does my Father love me, because I lay down my life that I might take it again. And so you understand, as you think about the shepherd that gave his life, the good shepherd that refers us back to Psalm 22. Now, as we think about Psalm 23, look at Hebrews chapter 13. In Hebrews chapter 13, reading from verse 20, talks about the shepherd. This is the great shepherd that provides for everything that we need. It says now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus. Is risen again now in this verse, and it calls him the great shepherd, that great shepherd of the sheep. through the blood of the everlasting covenant. And then it says in verse 21, it makes you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you, that which is well-pleasing in his sight. He gives us all the grace, he gives us his goodness, and he gives us all the gifts, everything we need, so that we can live a well-pleasing life in his sight. Through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. And then Psalm 24 talks about the glorious shepherd, the shepherd, the chief shepherd that is coming again. You think about 1 Peter. In 1 Peter chapter 5, we're looking at verse 4. 1 Peter chapter 5, we're reading from verse 4. It says, and when the chief shepherd shall appear, he's going to appear in glory. He's going to appear in majesty. He's coming again. As you remember Psalm 24, when it says that the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? That's the one we're reading about now. And when the chief shepherd shall appear, ye shall receive a crown of glory that fadeth not away. So, Psalm 22, the good shepherd. Psalm 23, the great shepherd. Psalm 24, the glorious shepherd. Today, we're looking at the message as we tie, as we put these three psalms together, we're looking at great salvation through the glorious shepherd. Great salvation through the glorious shepherd. We divide the message to three parts now. Number one, the substitutionary suffering of the propitiatory Savior, the one that provided for salvation, and the one that provided for redemption, the one that gave his life and his blood so that we can be saved. Number two is the sufficient supply of the perfect shepherd. You see all that he supplies. And as you look at Psalm 23, he supplies everything for the spirit, for the soul, for the body, for the ministry, for everything that concerns us. We lack nothing. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not lack. I shall not want. The sufficient supply of the perfect shepherd. Point number three, that's Psalm 24, the surpassing supremacy of the preeminent sovereign. The surpassing supremacy of the preeminent sovereign. Point number one, the substitutionary suffering of the propitiatory Savior. And that's in Psalm 22. As you look at Psalm 22, having 31 verses, we're going to look at them, at the verses section by section. Number one is the suffering of the sinless substitute. Look at Psalm 22 again, reading from verse 1. It says, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? I'm sure you recognize that as the word that Jesus spoke on the cross of Calvary. It was on the cross of Calvary now. He had been crucified and was suffering for our sin. And because of that suffering, the Father had to turn his face away from him because he was carrying the load and the penalty of the sin of the whole world. That's why he said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? In answer to that, look at 1 Peter chapter 3, and we're reading from verse 18. 1 Peter chapter 3, we're looking at verse 18, and you will discover why he was forsaken by the Lord. You see, for Christ also, as one suffered for sins, look at that, he has suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, bring put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit. He was our substitute. And that is why the Lord, the Father, turned his eyes away from him. Number two here is a supplication of the sorrowful soul. The supplication of the sorrowful soul. We're looking at Psalm 22 and we're reading from verse 4. Psalm 22 verse 4, our fathers trusted in thee, they trusted and thou didst deliver them. Then in verse 5, it says in verse 5, they cried unto thee and were delivered. They trusted in thee and were not confounded. You remember Jesus Christ, how he prayed in the garden of Gethsemane and then he was sweating out blood. He prayed and said, if this cup might pass by me, but not my will, but thine be done. And then the Lord answered his prayer. How do we say the Lord answered his prayer? Look at Hebrews chapter 5 and verse 7. Hebrews chapter 5, reading from verse 7, we're told that in the days of his flesh, who? In the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayers and supplications with strong crying and tears unto him that was able to save him from death. He shouldn't have died in the Garden of Gethsemane. He should go to the cross and make the sacrifice for our sin. And so he prayed. And even though it was a sweating blood and the heart was bleeding, yet the Lord saved him from death there. And he was heard in that he feared the supplication of the sorrowful soul. He said, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful unto death. But the Lord answered his prayer and sent an angel from heaven who delivered him from death, the death at Gethsemane, because he had to go to Calvary to die. But you know, as you come back to Psalm 22, in Psalm 22, we're looking at verse 6. In Psalm 22, verse 6, here it is scorn against the spotless sacrifice. The scorn against the spotless sacrifice. It was giving a sacrifice. It was to be the sacrifice for our sins, spotless and sinless and holy and righteous. But look at it in Psalm 22 verse 6. It says, but I am a worm and no man, a reproach of men and despised of the people. They scorned him. They despised him. In verse 7, it says in verse 7, all they that see me laugh me to scorn. All they that see me laugh me to scorn. They shoot out the lip. They shake the head, saying, what did they say? In verse 8, it says, he trusted on the Lord that he would deliver him. Let him deliver him, seeing he delighted in him. You remember when he was on the cross of Calvary, how those chief priests and all the people said, let him come down from the cross, and that we may believe him if he is really the king of the Jews. They scorned him, and that is because he was paying the price for our salvation. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 5. In 1 Corinthians chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 7. It tells us about Jesus Christ, who is the sacrifice. Put out therefore the old leaven, that ye may be a new lump, as ye are unleavened. Look at this. For even Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. We'll come back to Psalm 22. And in Psalm 22, in verse 12, he's telling us about their sarcasm. He's telling us about their utterances against him. In Psalm 22, verse 12, many bulls have compassed me, strong bulls of Bashan beset me around. In verse 13, it says in verse 13, they gaped upon me with their mouths as a ravening and a roaring lion. Then in verse 14, it says in verse 14, I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted in the midst of my bowels. Look at verse 15 there. In verse 15, my strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue cleaveth to my jaws, and thou hast brought me into the dust of death. You see, this cast aspersions on him and sarcasm against him. Was he surprised? when he actually bore that note, because the Old Testament prophets had prophesied that these things will happen. In Isaiah chapter 52, the last two verses there, in verses 14 and 15, it says, as many were astonished at thee, his visage was so much more than any man, and his form more than the sons of men. Look at verse 15. In verse 15, it tells us, in verse 15, it says, so shall he sprinkle many, many nations. The king shall shut their mouths at him, their sarcasm there, for that which had not been told them shall they see, and that which they had not heard shall they consider. Look at Isaiah chapter 53, reading there from verse 2. Isaiah 53, verse 2, for he shall grow up like before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of a dry ground. He has no form, no comeliness, and when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. Verse 3 says, in verse 3 it says, he is despised, they cast aspersions, as I told you, on him, and they use the word of sarcasm, they despised him, and he was rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. But why? Look at verse 4. It says in verse 4, surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. That's how we call this, we're titled this, the sarcasm against the smitten son. It was smitten of God. And then it tells us in verse 5, it says, but he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. And with his stripes you are healed. And with his stripes I am healed. Let's look at number 5, is a sacrilege against the scourged Savior. You know the story already, the story of his arrest, and the story of his trial, and the story of his crucifixion, and the story of his death, of his burial, and resurrection. And you remember how they scourged him? We're coming to Psalm 22, and we're reading from verse 16. Psalm 22, verse 16, for dogs have compassed me, the assembly of wicked men have enclosed me, they pierced my hands and my feet. I'm sure you understand, that did not happen to David. That did not happen to any prophet, any king, any priest in Israel. It happened to the Lord. This was prophetic utterance concerning the Lord Jesus Christ. In verse 17, says, I may tell all my bones, they look and stare upon me. And then in verse 18, they patch my garments among them. They patch my garments among them and cast lots upon my vesture. That tells us about those terrible things they did against him. They spat on him. They slapped him. They knocked him, they put a crown of thorns on him, and they said things, blasphemous things against him. The sacrilege against the scourged Savior. And now we come to number 6. Let's come back to Psalm 22 now. After Psalm 22 is assuring us in verse 26 that even though all those things happen to him, he'll not be on the cross forever. And he will not be in death in the grave forever. He will rise. And when he rises up, many will come to believe on him. And it says in Psalm 22, reading from verse 26, the meek shall eat and be satisfied. They shall praise the Lord that seek him. Your heart shall live forever. Look at that. Christ is going to rise up. That's what the psalmist is saying. All that has been done from verse 1 to verse 7 to verse 8 and to verse 15 to verse 16 and to verse 18 and everything that talks about his death, it says it will rise. And then those who seek him and those who believe on him, they will live with him and they shall live forever. In fact, it talks about us in verse 27, it says, all the ends of the world shall remember and turn unto the Lord. You remember, he shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, where he was crucified, and then in Judea, in the province of those people that put him to death, and in Samaria, beyond Judea, and to the uttermost part of the earth, because he died for salvation, and because he rose again. This is what is going to happen. All the ends of the world shall remember and turn to the Lord. We'll remember his crucifixion. We'll remember his death. We'll remember his substitutionary sacrifice. We'll remember his words on the cross. We'll remember the salvation, the redemption he has provided for us. And it's not going to happen only in Jerusalem. Yes, it will happen there. Only in Judea. It will happen there. Samaria. It will happen there. It will happen all over the world. That's why I said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Tell them, I died for them. All the ends of the world shall remember and turn unto the Lord, and all the kindreds of the nations shall worship before him. And then number 7, here is the service of all the submissive saints. The service of all the submissive saints. We're coming to verse 28, for the kingdom is the Lord's. You know, is the king, not only the king of the Jews, is the king not only of the world, is the king of the whole universe, and is the king of every generation. From that time until this time, until he will come again, he is the king, and he will reign forever and ever. The kingdom is the Lord's, and he is the governor among the nations. He is the ruler among the nations. He is the Lord among the nations. He is the controller. He is the captain of our salvation. He is the captain and the ruler among all the nations. The government shall be upon him, and his name shall be called Wonderful. His name shall be called Counselor. His name shall be called the Prince of Peace. His name shall be called the Everlasting Father. His name shall be called the Eternal God, Emmanuel, God with us. And he will be the governor among the nations. He will reign forever and ever. He's actually reigning now in the hearts of all his children, of all the people that believe on him. It tells us in verse 29, all day that befart upon earth shall eat and worship. All day that go down to the dust shall bow before him, and none can keep alive his own soul. It takes the Lord by his sacrifice, by his redemption, to keep us alive and to make our souls come alive. In verse 30, it says, his seed shall serve him. His seed shall serve him. The seed of believers, the seed of Abraham, the seed of David, the people that have that same faith of Abraham, and they believe on the Lord, and the righteousness of the Lord is imputed unto us. His seed shall serve him. It shall be accounted to the Lord for a generation. Now the final verse in verse 31. They shall come and shall declare his righteousness unto a people that shall be born, that he has done this. Look at that verse. It says the apostles will come, and those who submit to him as a servant will come, as the stewards of the mysteries of God. They will come and they will declare his righteousness. that he made him to be sin offering for us, that he, even though he knew no sin, that we who were sinners might not be accounted the righteousness of God in him. And then from generation to generation, we'll pass that message on, the message of redemption and the message of our salvation, and we're declaring the righteousness of Christ unto a people that shall be born from generation to generation, that this is what Christ has done. It's done it for you, it's done it for me, and because it's done that, it's become our sacrifice, it's become our Savior, it's become our substitute, it has become our sin bearer. He took our sins away. He turned us from sinners to saints. He turned us from goats to, he turns us now to the sheep. And he makes us to believe in him. We now call him our Savior. That's his name. We call him our Shepherd. That's his name. That brings us now to Psalm 23. And in Psalm 23, we're looking at this second part now. The second part that tells us about the sufficient supply of the perfect shepherd. The sufficient supply of the perfect shepherd is perfect. And he supplies all our need. And as you have believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you become sheep of his pasture. And he says, my sheep know my voice, and they follow me. And this is the supply he has given unto us. Point number two, the sufficient supply of the perfect shepherd. Come to Psalm 23, verse 1. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Number one here, he is the perfect shepherd redeemer. He's shepherd and then he's redeemer. He has redeemed us. And because he has redeemed us, it is perfection. We have the total supply. We have abundant supply. We have sufficient supply of everything he has given. We're looking at John chapter 10. In John chapter 10, we're reading from verse 11. John chapter 10, verse 11, it says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. He was, he is, he will ever be. And for everyone who believes today, he still say, I am. There's no change. I am. I'm still yours. I'm still your shepherd. And you can also say, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. I lay down my life for the sheep. Why? So that he will grant us redemption and he becomes our redeemer. Look at verse 14. In verse 14, it says, I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep. I know my sheep. I know my sheep, and I'm known. I am known of mine. And that makes him our redeemer. We're looking at Isaiah chapter 59. Isaiah chapter 59. We're reading from verse 20. In Isaiah chapter 59, verse 20, is talking about our redeemer. And the redeemer shall come to Zion and unto them that turn from transgression in Jacob, says the Lord. As we turn from transgression, as we turn from our sins, it becomes our redeemer, our shepherd. Come back to Psalm 23, verse 1. It says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. What's that talking about? Because he's my shepherd, I will not lack salvation. He is my Savior, and if the Savior is mine, I have his salvation. He is my Redeemer. If the Redeemer is mine, I have his redemption. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not lack salvation. I shall not lack redemption, because he's a shepherd, because he's a substitute, because he's a Savior, because he is the good shepherd that gave his life for the sheep. That's the reason why we now have salvation. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, reading from verse 9. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, we're looking at verse 9. For God has not appointed us unto wrath. Wrath is gone. Indignation is gone. Judgment is gone. He's brought us from judgment unto justification. For God has not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ. No other way to obtain salvation. We obtain salvation. We receive salvation through the Lord Jesus Christ. Remember, because the Lord is my shepherd, because the Lord is my Savior, because the Lord is my Redeemer, I have salvation, you have salvation. I have redemption, you have redemption. It tells us in Hebrews chapter 9, reading from verse 12. Hebrews chapter 9, reading from verse 12, is talking about the blood of the Lamb that took away all our sin and gave us perfect redemption, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood he entered in once into the holy place. He's done that for you. He's done that for me. After the sacrifice, he took his own blood, so to say, and he appeared in heaven before the Lord so that the Lord will see. Of course, he knew that our sins have not been atoned for, having obtained eternal redemption for us. Having obtained eternal redemption for us. We'll come back to the Psalms in Psalm 23, verse 1. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He gives us a perfect supply of his riches. The perfect supply of his riches. The Lord is my shepherd. The Lord of heaven is my shepherd. The Lord of all riches is my shepherd. The Lord of all supply is my shepherd. The Lord who lacks nothing and the Lord who has everything is my shepherd. And because everything that belongs to him belongs to me, I've become an heir of God, a joint heir with the Lord Jesus Christ. Because of that, I shall not want. When he says the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want, we say that gives us the supply of his riches. In Ephesians chapter 3, reading from verse 8, it talks about the unsearchable riches of Christ unto me, who am less than the least of all saints. Is this grace given unto me, who am less than the least of all saints? Is this grace given? He gave it to Paul, gave it to Peter, give it to the rest of the apostles and disciples and the followers and all the believers. He's giving it to you too, that I should be, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of his, of Christ. The unsearchable riches, the inexhaustible riches, the deep riches and the unlimited riches of Christ. And because the Lord is now your shepherd, he gives you those unsearchable riches, inexhaustible riches, unlimited riches of Christ. And that's why he tells us in Philippians chapter 4, reading from verse 19, when he says, my God shall supply all you need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. My God shall supply. That means you have a perfect shepherd, perfect redeemer. You have perfect salvation and perfect redemption. You have perfect supply of his riches. Number four, look at Psalm 23 verse 2. In Psalm 23 verse 2, the perfect security and rest. Perfect security and rest. It says, he maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. David himself, he was a shepherd. And he will conduct, he will direct, he will take the sheep out. And the sheep will have confidence. They'll have the new security. Whatever wild animal, whatever lion was there, they rested their mind because they could see the shepherd. And because David the shepherd was there, they drank the water where he led them to. They'll not be drinking and looking up, drinking and looking sideways, and drinking and fearing, and drinking and panicking, thinking a lion might come, because of the presence of the shepherd. And they knew that their shepherd could handle any lion, could handle any bear. Because of that, they had perfect security and rest. That's why Jesus Jesus said in Matthew chapter 11, reading from verse 28, it says in Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And I will give you rest. Rest for you, for your soul, for your spirit, and for your body, for your life. It says in verse 29, it says, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your soul. Ye shall find rest unto your soul. Now, come back to Psalm 23, and we're looking at that verse 2 again. In Psalm 23, verse 2, it says, he maketh me to lie down in green pastures. Just look at this. And he leadeth me beside the still waters. He leadeth me beside the still waters. The perfect satisfaction and refreshing. The perfect satisfaction and refreshing. You see, the Lord, being a shepherd, he supplies everything and he makes you satisfied. When you come to Christ, you are satisfied. When you come to Christ, he provides everything for you and there is refreshing. In fact, we're told in Acts of the Apostles, chapter 3, reading from verse 19, Acts of the Apostles, chapter 3, verse 19, repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing, the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. Now, because it's your shepherd, because it's your Savior, because it's your sanctifier, and because it's your substitute, and every dryness, every weariness you should go to, you should encounter, is encountered everything. And therefore, there is no dryness anymore. You are refreshed. The times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. Then in verse 20, it says, and he shall send Jesus Christ, which before was preached unto you. Before was preached unto you. That's what grants us the satisfaction and the refreshing. We're coming back to Psalm 23 and we're looking at verse 3. Psalm 23, verse 3, he restoreth my soul. He restoreth my soul. This is talking to us now about the perfect stage of restoration. Having gone astray, having gone away from the Lord, now the psalmist is saying, but you know, my shepherd, I went away as a prodigal sheep. I went away as a prodigal son. I went astray as a prodigal daughter, but now he searched for me. He looked for me. He sought for me, and he brought me back, and now my soul is restored. He grants us the perfect stage of restoration. That's what the Lord does. If anyone has gone away, he can restore the joy of salvation. He can restore all that were lost in our going astray, because he is our Lord. And now we come back to him. In 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 25, 1 Peter chapter 2, reading from verse 25, it says, but we were a sheep going astray, but now are returned unto the shepherd and bishop of our souls. We're restored. He gives us the perfect restoration, and we now abide, and we now remain, and we now live in the perfect stage of restoration. But not only that, everything we have lost, our health, everything we have lost, the peace of mind, everything we have lost, our stability, everything we have lost, our serenity, he gives us back everything. And this is the promise of the Lord for you, for me, and for everyone that is fully restored unto the Lord. In Jeremiah chapter 30, verse 17, Jeremiah chapter 30, verse 17, it says, and I, for I will restore health unto thee, health unto thee, and I will heal thee of thy wounds, says Then, Lord, he restores health, he restores peace, he restores everything we have lost. When the prodigal son came back in the parable that Jesus told, everything he had lost, the peace and the feasting and all the satisfaction, everything was restored. He's promised to us the same thing. And as we come to the Lord fully, and as we return very well to the presence of the Lord, he restores everything. Number seven, let's come back to Psalm 23 and let's read the next part of verse 3 there. Psalm 23, we're looking at verse 3. It says, He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. He restoreth my soul, and then he leads me in the paths, in the steps of righteousness for his name's sake. That talks about the perfect steps of righteousness, the perfect steps of righteousness. No matter how deep down anyone might have gone into backsliding, into the degradation of sin, when you come up, when you come back to the shepherd and bishop of our souls, he gives us complete righteousness, and he leads us step by step in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. He actually makes us righteous. He's able to do that. Look at Romans chapter 6, reading from verse 18. Romans chapter 6, reading from verse 18. Being then made free from sin is the one that does that. He cleanses us with his blood. He reassures us with his word of forgiveness, and then he sets us free with his power of redemption. Being then made free from sin, he became the servants of righteousness. And he puts our feet on the path again, and he leads us on, and he encourages us on, and he guides us on in the paths of righteousness. We come now to Psalm 23 again, and we're looking at verse 4. Psalm 23, we're looking at verse 4. It says in verse 4, yet though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. It says, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, it said, he has conquered death for me. And because he has conquered death for me, premature death is canceled. Unexpected death is canceled. And the second death, the death that leads a person to eternal, perpetual death, all that is canceled. And now all that remains is the shadow of death. It says the power of death, the sting of death has been taken away because Christ as my substitute died for me. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Why that? How about that? That now we can walk in the valley of the shadow of death, and yet there is nothing here that we fear. We now have perfect safety and reassurance. And let's look at Psalm 138, Psalm 138. I'm reading from verse 7. Psalm 138, verse 7. It tells us, though I walk in the midst of trouble, the trouble that may even be death for other people, though I walk in the midst of trouble, thou wilt revive me. Thou shalt stretch forth thine hand against the wrath of mine enemy, and thy right hand shall save me, and thy right hand will hold me up. Look at verse 8. Verse 8, you want to mark your Bible, the Lord will perfect that which concerneth me. I'm sure you'll be looking for that verse. Where is that verse in the Bible that says God will perfect everything concerning me, everything concerning my family, everything concerning my ministry? Here is the verse for you. The Lord will perfect that which concerneth me. Thy mercy, O Lord, endureth forever. Forsake not the works of thine own hand. And look at Jeremiah chapter 23, and we're looking at verse 6. Jeremiah chapter 23, and we're reading from verse 6. In his days shall Judah be saved. In the days of this shepherd, in the days of this Savior, in the days of this Redeemer, shall Judah be saved, and Israel shall dwell safely. This is his name, whereby he shall be called the Lord our righteousness. The Lord our righteousness. That's what gives us reassurance, and that is what gives us security. We're coming back to Psalm 23, and we're reading from verse 4. In Psalm 23, verse 4, it says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Look at this. For thou art with me. That's Emmanuel, God with us. Thou art with me. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. It says, thou art with me. Do so, we should be able to boldly say, the Lord is my helper. Of what will I be afraid? I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. There's a perfect strength of his rod. There's a perfect strength of his rod. The sheep looks at the shepherd, and the shepherd has a rod in the hand. That rod, he will deal with every enemy with that rod. And because of that rod, the sheep is not afraid. He knows that that rod is able. The rod of God in the hand of Moses is able. And the rod of the shepherd in the hand of David, that's enough. And the rod of God, the word like the rod that comes out of the mouth of the Messiah, of the Savior, that's enough. In Psalm 110, reading from verse 2. Psalm 110, reading from verse 2. It tells us, the Lord shall send the rod of thy strength out of Zion. The rod of thy strength out of Zion. That rod has strength, rule thou in the midst of thine enemies. That's why the sheep is not afraid. When we can see that rod in the hand of the shepherd. In fact, it tells us in verse 3, it says in verse 3, thy people shall be willing in the day of thy power. The day of thy power. What day are we living in? The day of the power of our shepherd. The day of the power of our sovereign. The day of the power of the great bishop and shepherd of our soul. Thy people shall be willing in the day of thy power, in the beauties of holiness, from the womb of the morning. Thou hast the dew of thy youth. And we'll come back to Psalm 23, and we're reading from verse 4. Psalm 23, verse 4, it talks about thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. The rod against the enemy, and the staff also can be against the enemy, but also can draw back the sheep that is going astray. It says, as I see the double protection, and I see the double manifestation of your love and of your ability to deal with Satan and then to bring back the sheep, it says, that comforts me. I know that all shall be well. In Isaiah chapter 59, reading from verse 19, Isaiah chapter 59, reading from verse 19, so shall they fear the name of the Lord from the west, and his glory from the rising of the sun. Look at this now. Look at this. When the enemy shall come in like a flood, when the enemy shall rush in like a flood, when the enemy shall try to pounce upon the sheep like a flood, it says, the Spirit of the Lord shall lift up his standard against him. The staff, the rod in the hand of the shepherd against the enemy that comes in like a flood. It says, that is why I have the peace and the security, the perfect security for the righteous. That's what he gives us. We come now back to Psalm 23, and we're looking at verse 5. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. My cup runneth over. My cup running over. Your cup will run over. In the presence of the shepherd, in the presence of the Savior, our cup runs over. Thou preparest a table before me, and it's in the presence of mine enemies. Some people feel they cannot progress until their enemies are dead. Some people think they cannot rise until their enemies are dead. Therefore, they are all the time. Instead of looking at the shepherd, they're looking at the enemy. Instead of looking at the provision, the abundant provision, the super abundant provision of the shepherd, they're looking at the power of the enemy. And they're fasting and they're praying, if all my enemies could die. No, but the psalmist said, I have a shepherd. I'm not dealing with enemies. I'm relating with the shepherd. And the shepherd is mine all the time. And because the shepherd is mine, I know I shall not lack. I know I shall not want. I know that I have the faith and the trust and the confidence in the shepherd that supplies everything I need. And I have the perfect super abundance which is made for the righteous. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head, anointing. The anointing that breaks every yoke. There are people that wonder, do I still have the anointing? Is the anointing running dry? Do I have the anointing for ministry? Anointing for the work I have to do? Anointing to fulfill my calling and to fulfill my ministry? The psalmist said, the anointing does not run dry. The anointing remains and abides. And because the anointing remains and abides, in fact, the anointing is even increasing. The anointing is running over. It says, thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. The super abundance that he has given us, the righteous people. Look at Ephesians chapter 3. We're looking at verse 20. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20. It says, now unto him that is able. Our God is able. Our shepherd is able. Our Savior is able. The bishop of our souls is able. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. According to the power that worketh in us. The Lord has called us. He's called us into his very presence. And in his presence, the super abundance of all the needs of our lives. That's why he said, the thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. Then he said, I am come as a savior. I am come as a shepherd. I am come as your provider. I am come as your protector. I am come as your redeemer. I am come as your supplier. I am come that she may have life and that she may have life more abundantly. Let's come back to Psalm 23. In Psalm 23 verse 6, it says, now surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. It says, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. It says, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. You know what? Christ the Savior, Christ the Shepherd, Christ the Redeemer, Christ the Righteous One, and Christ the Supplier of every need, he does not withdraw any of his goodness. He does not withdraw his grace. He does not withdraw his mercy all the days of our lives. You're saved, move on. You're sanctified, go on. You're baptized in the Holy Ghost, go on. You have the gifts of God in your life, go on. You're called as a servant into the ministry, go on. All the days and every turn of the way, he supplies the goodness and the mercy. And the devil cannot decrease that. Persecutors cannot decrease that. Surely Certainly, without any shadow of doubt, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Look at this, and I thought you'll say it for yourself, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. That means he gives us a perfect shelter in his eternal residence. Perfect shelter in his eternal residence. It tells us in John chapter 17, we're reading from verse 23. John chapter 17, reading from verse 23, I in them and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that thou hast sent me and hast loved them, and hast loved them as thou hast loved me. Do you ever think about that? That the love of God for you is the same as the love of God for Christ. Why? Because we're the body of Christ. We're members of his body. And as he loves the head, he loves the body. You look at a man, a complete man, the head and then the body. Can you love the head and not love the body? You love the totality of the man. And because now there is an inseparable connection between Christ and the church, between Christ the head and church, the body, he loves the body, he loves the believers, you in particular, he loved you as God has loved Christ. Look at verse 24. In verse 24, it says, Father, I will. Father, I desire. Father, I want, I demand that they also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am. Be with me where I am is eternal residence. Be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me. For thou lovedst me before the foundation of the world. Let's come back to Psalm 23. In Psalm 23 from verse 1, read this for yourself and understand this. Take this to yourself. If you have not been thinking about this, think about this every time and think about all that God has provided in Christ, all that God has supplied in Christ. And now you can say every day, not just in the past, not when you were younger Christian, but now, even at this time, now the Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is your shepherd, and I shall not want. You will not lack anything. And then in verse 2, remember what he's telling you. He maketh me, that's me, he maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside tilled waters. And then in verse 3, it says, he restoreth my soul. And tonight and every time you are restored fully and you know you are in the presence of the Lord, he leadeth me in a path of righteousness for his name's sake. And then in verse 4, even though there might be trouble, even though it might appear that, you know, death is raging and raining everywhere, but yet though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you will not die before your time, and you will not die a miserable death. When your time comes to go, you will go triumphantly. But now, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff. They are not for my destruction, thy rod and thy staff. They are not for my chastisement, thy rod and thy staff. They are against the enemy. And when I see that rod and the staff in the hand of my shepherd, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. And then in verse 5, it says, thou preparest, present tense, thou preparest, present tense, don't worry, don't take thought what you will eat, what you will drink, and wherewithal are you going to be clothed, because he prepares a table before you in the presence of your enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over, running over, running over, your cup will run over. Your joy will run over. Your peace will run over. The provision of the Lord in your life will run over. The power, spiritual power of God in your life will run over. My cup runneth over. And now in verse 6, tell me the first word there. I say, tell me the first word there. That's right. Surely there's a surety in your life. There's an assurance in your life. There is assurance that even tonight and throughout tonight, whatever is reaching in the community, surely goodness and mercy will follow you all the days of your life. And then when you finish your race here, you'll finish well and you will finish strong. And then you will cross over to the other side to be in the eternal residence of the Lord. And then it says, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord. For how long? Forever, forever, forever. In your life, in my life, in our lives, in Jesus' name. We come to point number three now. Point number three, we're looking at the surpassing supremacy of the preeminent sovereign. The surpassing supremacy of the preeminent sovereign. And this is Psalm 24. In Psalm 24, look at verse 1. The earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof, the world, and they that dwell therein. Look at verse 2. In verse 2, it says, for he has founded it upon the seas, and establish it upon the floods. Verse 3 asks a question. It says, so shall ascend into the hill of the Lord, or who shall dwell in his holy hill? In verse 4, it says, in verse 4, he that has clean hands and a pure heart, who has not lifted up his soul unto vanity nor sworn deceitfully. It tells us in verse 5, he shall receive the blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. Look at verse 6. In verse 6, it says, this is the generation. And I'm glad I'm in that generation. This is the generation. You are glad you are part of this generation. This is the generation of them that seek him, that seek thy face, O Jacob, Selah. And then in verse 7, it says, lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lift up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Verse 8 is asking a question, who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty. The Lord mighty in battle. He wants us to have reassurance. He's asking again in verse 9. It says, lift up your heads, O ye gates, even lift them up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Verse 10. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. It says, Selah. Pause and think about that. As we look at this psalm, we're looking at the supremacy of the preeminent sovereign, of the preeminent Lord, of the preeminent governor, of the preeminent ruler, of the preeminent King of kings and Lord of lords, is surpassing supremacy. Number one, the creation and possession of the earth by God. The creation and the possession of the earth by God. Look at Psalm 24 verse 1. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. The earth is the Lord's. The Lord is our shepherd. The Lord is our God. The Lord is our governor. The Lord is our creator, and the earth is the Lord's. Everything on earth belongs to the Lord. Every state in our country belongs to the Lord. Every province, every prefecture in your country belongs to the Lord. Every land, every parcel of land there belongs to the Lord. And he has created you, and if he sends you there to go and minister, that's the territory of the Lord. That's the land of the Lord. The earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof, even the whole world and they that dwell in them. All those people that dwell on the earth they are creatures of our God, of our Father. It's like if your father, your earthly father, your literal biological father has built a house. It's gone beyond that. He has built an estate. And you, the son, or you, the daughter, you're moving around in that estate, or you're living in one of the rooms of that house, of that mansion that your father has built. And every time you come out in the morning, you remember, all this belongs to my father. All this belongs to my shepherd. All this belongs to my God. All this belongs to my Creator. And the people that dwell therein, you'll not be walking about as if you're a stranger. And then you'll not be afraid of this and that. They're all tenants in the house, in the mansion, in the community, in the estate that your father has created. Everything belongs to the Lord. Look at verse 2. It says in verse 2, for he has founded it upon the seas. That's what the scientists will tell you, that the earth, the solid ground, underneath you have the seas, you have the ocean. He has founded it upon the seas and established it upon the floods. Everything belongs to the Lord. Look at Psalm 89, we're reading from verse 11. Psalm 89, reading from verse 11. It says, the heavens are thine, the stars are thine, the galaxies are thine, the planets are thine, the heavens are thine, and the earth also is thine. As nobody, no human being can lay claim to the sun, no human being can lay claim to the moon, and no human being can lay claim to the stars, and no human being can lay claim to the planets. The same thing, no human being can lay claim to the earth. It belongs to our shepherd. It belongs to our creator. It belongs to our Lord. The heavens are thine, and the earth also is thine. For as for the world and the fullness thereof, thou hast founded them. They all belong to the Lord. Look at Revelation chapter 4, verse 11. Revelation chapter 4, we're looking at verse 11. It says, thou art worthy, O Lord. That's my Lord. Thou art worthy, O Lord. That's your Lord. That's the Lord who is your shepherd. And that shepherd is worthy, that Lord is worthy. Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power. Look at this. For thou hast created all things, the heavens and the earth. Thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are, and they were created. For thy pleasure they are and were created. And remember now that every child of God is a member of the body of Christ, is part of the Lord, bone of his bone and flesh of his flesh. And if all things are for his pleasure, because he created them, he's not withholding them from you. They are for your pleasure as well. Now we come to Psalm 24, and we're reading from verse 3, and we're reading from verse 4 as well. It says in verse 3, who shall ascend to the hill of the Lord? And who shall stand in his holy place? The psalmist knew, and I'm sure you know, that the earth is not our place of abode for all eternity. There is the hill of the Lord. There is the house of the Lord. There is the habitation of the Lord. In my father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. The Lord Jesus Christ prayed and he said, Father, I will that they whom you have given me will come and see my glory, which I had with you before the foundation of the world. He wants us to ascend to the hill of the Lord and to abide and to stand and to dwell forever in his holy place. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. But now he's asking a question. He's saying, who are the people? And what are the qualifications that will take us there? Who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord? Or who shall stand in his holy place? Look at verse 4. The condition of purity for eternity with God. The condition of purity for eternity with God. He that has clean hands and a pure heart, who has not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully. Those are the people who will go to heaven and abide in that eternal residence of God forever and ever. The condition of purity for eternity with God. Clean hands. Look at Job chapter 17, reading from verse 9. Job chapter 17, reading from verse 9, the righteous also shall hold on his way, and he that has clean hands shall be stronger and stronger. Those who were sinners, but he turned and repented, and the Lord Jesus Christ forgave them, and he gave them his righteousness, and he made them righteous, and is leading them now in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. And they're holding on to their way, and they're holding on to the grace of God. The righteous also shall hold on his way. He that has clean hands will not be weaker and weaker, but will be stronger and stronger, will be brighter and brighter, and will shine forth farther and farther, and be cleaner and cleaner, and is making progress in the path of righteousness. Is stronger today than it was yesterday, is brighter today than it was yesterday, is purer today than it was yesterday. He that has clean hands shall be stronger and stronger. He makes us to have clean hands because he washes us, because he cleanses us, and we keep on cleansing ourselves. In 2 Corinthians, reading from chapter 7, verse 1. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, reading from verse 1. It says, having therefore, dearly beloved, these promises, let us cleanse ourselves. That's how we become stronger and stronger, purer and purer. That's how we become cleaner and cleaner. Let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness and filthiness and filthiness of the flesh and of the spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. But it's not only that we have clean hands, we have a pure heart. How does that happen? We're looking at Acts chapter 15, and we're reading from verse 9. Acts chapter 15, we're reading from verse 9. It says, and he put no difference between us and them. He put no difference between us apostles and the disciples. He put no difference between us Jews and the Gentiles. He put no difference between us who saw Christ face to face when he was here on earth and them in the house of Cornelius who had never seen the Lord face to face. For those first century Christians and for these 21st century Christians now, the same thing. He put no difference between us of that time and them of this coming time, purifying their hearts by faith. Purifying their hearts by faith. We have peace with God in salvation, and we have purity in Christ by sanctification. Peace with God, salvation is by faith, and purity in Christ, the purity of heart, sanctification is also by faith. And we remain and we abide in that purity of heart. I come back now to Psalm 24, and we're reading from verse 7. Lift up thy head, O ye gates, and be ye lift up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. The announcement will soon come. The angel will blow the trumpet, And then all the gates will be lifted up, and the heavens will be clear, and the clouds will be clear. And then as we look up, we'll see the Lord, the Sovereign One. We'll see the Lord, the Royal One. We'll see the Lord, the coming King. We'll see him descending from glory. And then it says, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? Let's look at James chapter 2. James chapter 2, we're reading from verse 1, telling us about the identity of the King of glory. My brethren, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, the Prince of glory, the King of glory, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with respect of persons. He identifies the Lord as the King of glory. The name is Jesus, because the King of glory is going to come from glory. And those of us who believe on him will rise from the dead, those who have died, and then those who have not died, they will be caught up, will be raptured to be with him in glory. It tells us in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 9. Hebrews chapter 2, reading from verse 9, it says, But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, but we see him now crowned with glory and honor. Crowned with glory and honor. Crowned with glory and honor. He's coming back, and when he comes back, he'll come with the clouds, and he'll come with glory. And those of us who are now believers will be caught up together with him. To the Jewish people, it was a mystery. And to the people reading the Old Testament, it was a mystery. They didn't know who the King of glory was and when the King of glory will come. But then it tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, reading from verse 51, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, reading from verse 51, behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. The time is coming, and it may be sooner than anyone thought. I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In verse 52, it says in verse 52, telling about the coming glory and talking about how the King of glory will come in with splendor and with honor, and then we shall be with him in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye at the last trump. In the twinkling of an eye at the last trump, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. And we shall be changed, and will take part in that glory. You will take part in that glory. Colossians chapter 3, looking at verse 4. In Colossians chapter 3, verse 4, it tells us that when Christ, who is our life, shall appear, when Christ, who is our substitute, shall appear, when Christ, who is our Savior, shall appear, when Christ, who is our sin bearer, shall appear, when Christ, who is our shepherd, shall appear, when Christ, who is our sovereign, our Lord, our King, when he shall appear, when Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also, my brother, what's your name? Then will you also, my sister, what's your name? Then will you also appear with him in glory. He's coming. The King of glory is coming. The Lord of glory is coming. The King of kings and the Lord of lords is coming. And when he comes, he'll come in glory. He'll come with glory. And then we shall all be with him. I pray you'll be with him. I pray your family will gather together with him at his feet. I pray all your converts, all our converts, all our members will gather with him, and we shall all, preacher and the people of God, the minister and the members of the church, we shall all appear with him in glory, in Jesus' name. We've learned a lot today, and we need to take what we've learned to the Lord in prayer, that the Lord will write these things upon the tables of our heart, that will remember that Jesus Christ is that glorious shepherd and has given us so great salvation. Brother, let's rise up. Sister, let's rise up. And as leaders, let's have the first fruits of the blessing of God, that we will be competent, will be strengthened to go and share with other people, with members of our congregation. Thank you. Thank you, brother. Thank you, sister. Rise up and let us pray. Take everything to the Lord in prayer, that the Lord Jesus Christ will be made known unto us as our substitute. He bore everything for you. Why don't you thank the Lord for that? That he has borne everything for you. He's your substitute. He went through that sorrow. My soul is exceedingly sorrowful unto death. So that sorrow of eternal punishment and that sorrow of the sins committed in the past, that sorrow will be taken away from you. It's your spotless sacrifice. And the sacrifice of Christ is acceptable unto the Lord. He has accepted him. He has accepted his sacrifice. And he has accepted you because you came through that sacrifice. He is the smitten son. He smote him on your behalf. He smote him on your behalf so that you will not be smitten by the wrath of God anymore. He was scourged. He was tried. The stripes of your healing, they were laid upon him. And whatever sickness and whatever infirmity and whatever weakness, whatever it is, whatever the medical report, you are healed by his stripes. He was scourged as your healer. And now we can come to him because we're saved and we're seeking him. And we're satisfied in every supply he has made. Not only that, now we can serve him as submissive saints. We're submissive unto him. And we're willing to serve him. And we're ready to serve him and serve him with all our heart, all our soul, and all our mind, and everything we have, we bring now on the table, we bring to the open so that we can serve him. Let's tell the Lord, I'll serve him. If he died for all, then we're all dead, that those who live now should not henceforth live unto themselves, but live unto him that loved them and died for them. Because he died for us to save us. He died for us to sanctify us. He has now made us zealous of good works. Tell the Lord, lay everything upon the altar again, so that from today you'll serve him better than ever before. So that today you'll serve the church of the living God better than ever before. And remember now, the Lord is your shepherd. And because the shepherd is the captain of our salvation, is a perfect Savior, is a perfect Redeemer, there is nothing he should have done that he has not done. Complete and full and final and perfect. And blameless, perfect Savior, perfect Redeemer. And think about the salvation he has given us. It's not a faulty salvation. It's not a deficient salvation. It's not a kind of weak salvation. Salvation, perfect salvation, and perfect redemption. Redemption from sin. Redemption from all the corruption of society. Perfect. And redemption from all the power of the enemy. Perfect, complete, entire, and full. And because of that, you can walk in the way of salvation, in the way of righteousness. It grants us a perfect supply of the unsearchable riches of Christ, of the inexhaustible riches of Christ. What's your need? He supplied everything. And what's your demand? He will answer every prayer. Because those riches of Christ, from where you get your supply, they are inexhaustible, they are unlimited, and they are perfect, overflowing. And you can tell the Lord, and he'll grant unto you. And he gives us security. Not porous security, perfect security. And your life is hid with Christ in God. Lions, no, they will not catch you. Evil people, no, they will not get you. Untimely death, no, it will not come to you. You're given a perfect security and perfect rest. Not only that, he also grants you perfect satisfaction and refreshing. He leads you by the still waters, not roaring stormy water. He's taking all the storm away. And now you can have peace in your heart, satisfaction in your life, and refreshing. No more dryness. No more dryness. Do you feel dry? You shouldn't. Tell the Lord, I know you are leading me by the still waters and a satisfaction. He will satisfy your soul. And then he grants us the stage of restoration. You're not in a state of running helter-skelter or being unsettled. You are settled after restoration. He has restored your soul. And because he has restored your soul, he gives you that settled state of restoration. And he leads you in the path of righteousness. The steps of righteousness. He'll show you the way. Any challenge, any trial, any temptation, any crossroad, the step you ought to take, the path in which you ought to walk, that will maintain the righteousness of the Savior. The righteousness of the sage. It will lead you continually in the steps of the righteousness of the Lord. Remember now the condition of purity, clean hands, and a pure heart. He gives us that through the blood of the Lamb, and he cleanses us, washes us, whiter than snow. And he purifies our heart. And he keeps us in that purity. He preserves us in that purity. And then when you will come, and the King of glory shall come in, and the everlasting doors, the doors that have been shut, restraining the Lord from coming all these many years and many generations, the trumpet shall sound. And those everlasting doors will be lifted up, and the King of glory and the Lord of glory and the Prince of glory shall come in. And when he shall appear, then those who are dead in Christ shall rise up. And those who are still alive, who remain alive, they will be raised together with him to share in his glory. You'll be with the Lord, I will be with the Lord, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. May he make you ready, prepared, until that time, in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for what you have revealed unto us concerning the good shepherd, concerning the great shepherd, concerning the glorious shepherd, concerning our Savior, substitute, and sin bearer. We thank you because he has taken our sins away. We bless your name because the Spirit of the Lord is bearing witness in our hearts. We are children of God. We are servants of the Lord. And we are saved seekers. And we are submissive servants. And now, everything we need as your children, everything we need as your sons and daughters, everything we need as your servants and stewards, you have made available, and you supply all our needs. And we know you give us rest and security. And we know you give us safety and refreshing. And we know you give us satisfaction in righteousness. And we know you give us the staff and the strength of your rod. And we know that you give us all the supply we need to have. enemies that might be there, enemies that might not be there, enemies that are imagined, enemies that are real. You set a table before every one of us in the presence of all enemies, and our cup of anointing, our cup of feasting, our cup of supply is running over. You're giving us an assurance, and I pray that assurance and that trust and that confident faith will be in everyone, that goodness and mercy shall follow every one of us all the days of our life, and will spend the days of our lives in courage, in confidence, and in real conviction. We'll spend our days in the abundant, superabundant provision that you have granted, you have provided for us. And when the time comes to go home, we'll finish well, we'll finish strong, and then we go home, and then we will live and abide with you forever and ever. While we're still here in this place of ministry, we pray you grant us the consciousness that the earth belongs to you. Everything we see, everything we don't see, everything is owned by you, and they are for our benefit. And we pray we'll benefit from them without fear and without shrinking, without, sinking down. In Jesus' name, we pray, Lord, we'll fear no tenant on earth, even Satan. This earth does not belong to him, or maybe neighbors and anybody in the village, in the town, in the city, on the road, anywhere. They are all your tenants, and you created them, you put them here, and we are the sons and the daughters of the Almighty God, Redeemer, Creator. Will not be afraid in Jesus' name. And we pray that all the peace of mind we need, the purity of heart we need, and the power we need, you supply everything, so that as we are walking towards the eternal residence, as we are walking towards the perfect paradise, as we are walking towards that place of God to prepare for us, we'll be holy, we'll be clean, we'll be spotless, and we'll be blameless in Jesus' name. And we pray that your glory will abide in our lives even now, until we appear with you in glory, in Jesus' name. Strengthen every brother, every sister, strengthen every minister, that, Lord, all that we ought to be, all that we ought to do, you grant us the grace, and they'll be done victoriously in Jesus' name. Put the spirit of the conqueror and the spirit of the overcomer in every one of your people, so that this work will be done fearlessly, faithfully, and fruitfully in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The Lord bless you and make the word bear fruit in your life. In Jesus' name.